According to the Bible, Jesus experienced two things immediately before he started his public ministry of preaching and teaching and doing miracles. First, he was baptized in the Jordan River by John the Baptist. And then he was led out into the desert wilderness to be tempted of Satan. And we're going to be focusing on that temptation today. We're glad that you've joined us, and we hope that God will speak to you as you share this time of worship, because we're going to look at the temptation of Jesus and see what we learn from that. For example, if he was tempted, then certainly it teaches us that nobody is exempt from Satan's attacks and temptations. We're also going to see that Satan never lets up. Every day that we live, he keeps trying to tempt us and to lead us astray from the Lord and from the truth. And then, as Jesus shows us in a very profound way, the best way to resist Satan and his attacks is with the Word of God, God's truth. And so, again, we hope that God will speak to your heart. Thank you for joining us. Let's go now into the worship time together.
True. Wherever the Lord is, that is a holy place. Thank you. Be seated, and the children can come forward.
Good morning. It's good to see all of you. We're glad that our little friends are with us. We're going to do a little demonstration. This is not really a magic trick. It's just kind of fascinating when you see what's going to happen here. But this is just a little piece of plastic. It's very light, and it's sort of shaped in the shape of a hook. And we're going to do something with that in just a moment. But I want you to think about how God keeps everything together and takes care of everything in the world. It's an amazing thing when you think about it. And He has the whole world to take care of and much more beyond this world. And yet He's willing to give His time and His attention and His love to all of us. And so He takes care of everything that He's made. He takes care of you.
and each one of us as well. So to help us think about that, I want to use this little piece of plastic shaped like a hook. And I'm going to ask Jonathan, see if you can balance this on the end of your finger anyway, okay? Not lying down flat, okay? That's too easy. We're talking about standing up like this. Do you think you can do that? Balance it on the end of one of your fingers? Let go with your thumb, okay? That was pretty sneaky. I like that. No, it's hard. I can't do it either. Okay, we can't, can we? Not really. Okay, it's just because of the way it's made, and you just can't balance it on the end of your finger. It just falls off. But I do have a way that you or any of us can do that. And believe it or not, we're actually going to make it even more difficult. We're going to hang this heavy belt on this hook. Now, do you think I can balance it on the end of my finger with all of that on it? Watch this. This is not a trick. Look at that. Isn't that something? I don't understand that either. I don't know how it works. It's not magic. It's just some kind of science or law of physics or something. But there it is. Jonathan, hold out your finger. I bet you can do it. Just hold it out straight. Stand up for us and demonstrate it, okay? There you go. Hold your finger out. Just hold it right there. Look at that. It works. I don't understand it. Hold it there just a minute, okay? Can you stay right there? Okay. So looking at Jonathan holding this heavy belt on this little piece of plastic that doesn't look like it could work, if he can do that, if Jonathan can make this happen, if he can hold all of this together, then think about how wonderful and powerful our God is, who holds everything together. He made everything. He keeps everything in place. He takes care of all that he has made. And again, that includes you and me as well. Matley, you want to try it? Okay. It does work. It does work. And again, I'm not sure I understand it. But as amazing as that is, it's more amazing and wonderful to know the God who loves us and cares for all of us as well. Let's thank him for that before you go back to your seat, okay? Heavenly Father, you are wonderful indeed. And today we thank you for all that you are and all that you do. And you tell us that you have made all things that exist. And you take care of the world and everything that you have made, including all of us. We praise you and thank you for that. Thank you most of all for sending your son Jesus to be our Savior and friend. And now we ask that you bless these precious children and their homes and families. In Jesus' name. Amen. A lady named Fanny Crosby lived to be 95 years of age. For over 94 of those years of her life, she was blind. She became blind as an infant, a newborn baby. And yet, God used her to touch the world with her music. Fanny Crosby wrote more than 6,000 Christian hymns. And we're glad that a few of them still find their way in our Baptist hymnal. We're looking at hymn number 446. Perhaps the best known and best loved of all Fanny Crosby songs, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. And notice in there when she refers to sight or vision as in verse 2. Remember, she is blind as she is writing these beautiful and powerful words. We'll sing all three verses. Number 446, stand with us, please.
This is my story.
Father, we thank you today for that blessed assurance that we have in Jesus. Thank you that with all the changes, with all the uncertainties of life, we can depend upon him now and forevermore. And we're reminded that because of Jesus, he represents your greatest gift to this world. And therefore, you have called us as your people to be a giving people. Thank you for the privilege of worshiping you through our gifts and helping you to expand your kingdom's work here locally and around the world. Bless all the gifts, we pray, in the precious name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Thank you. Please be seated.
As we open God's Word together, I call your attention to a few verses in the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, if you would like to follow along. Matthew chapter 4, beginning with verse 8. Again, the devil took him, that is Jesus, to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these things I will give you if you fall down and worship him, worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Go, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Pikes Peak in Colorado is an iconic natural wonder. In fact, it's the most visited mountain in the United States. I visited the top of Pikes Peak many years ago while I was out there on a short vacation. And that mountain stands 14,115 feet above sea level. And it is majestic and beautiful. Now, if you want to drive to the top of Pikes Peak, there's one way to go. It's the Pikes Peak Highway. It's a rather narrow two-lane road from the valley below to the summit. And that drive will take you 19 miles and almost an hour to get there because the speed limit is 25. So many hairpin turns and steep drop-offs where there are very few guardrails, if any. And it is a beautiful, beautiful place. And quite a breathtaking view from the summit. In fact, back in the late 1800s, a lady named Catherine Lee Bates was traveling across country by train. She left Massachusetts and went through Chicago and then through Kansas, and she ended up in Colorado Springs, Colorado. And she was determined to go to the top of Pikes Peak, which she did for a visit. And as she was standing there taking in this glorious view around and below her with the majestic Rocky Mountains all around, the words came to her, along with some other sights she had seen in her travel across country, that became a part of one of the most beautiful patriotic songs of all, America the Beautiful. And if you ever stand there on top of Pikes Peak, where she stood, and got inspiration for some of the lyrics of that song, then you can understand her reference to purple mountain majesties. One of the beautiful spots in America, the most visited mountain of all in our nation. Now, I share that because we are in a series of messages dealing with mountains that are mentioned in the Bible and important events that occurred on those mountains. 2 weeks ago, we looked at Mount Nebo, and we saw there the man Moses, after leading the children of Israel to the very threshold of the promised land, but not being allowed to enter it himself, God allowed him to go to the highest mountain on the far side of the Jordan River to look out and to view the promised land. And then the Bible says there Moses died, and from all indications, God buried him. Now, today we're looking at another mountain and what happened there. And this mountain is the mountain of temptation for Jesus. Now, there were a series of three temptations, and we will come back to that shortly. But today we're looking at the third of these temptations that occurred on a mountaintop. And there are several lessons for all of us from the temptation of Jesus as recorded here in the Bible. And I want us to take notice of them, to heed them, because God has something to say to each of us. Let's look at some lessons from the temptation of our Lord. Before he ever started his public ministry, there were two major events that happened. He was baptized in the Jordan River by John the Baptist, and then immediately he went out into the desert region for this series of temptations. Look with me at some lessons we learn. The temptation of Jesus, first of all, reminds us that no one is exempt from temptation. Think about this. Satan, the devil, had the audacity to tempt the Son of God. God in the flesh, who had left heaven to come here to be the Savior of all humanity. Satan dared to attack and assault our Savior with vicious temptations. And so that reminds us that no one is exempt from Satan's attacks. He tempts everyone.
Every day that we live, whether we're aware of those temptations or not, they come and they keep coming. Not long ago, there was a survey taken among readers of a certain Christian magazine. And one of the questions in that survey dealt with the greatest spiritual challenges to the readers who were taking the survey. That is, their strongest areas of temptation in their personal lives. What do you think were on the list? The top 9 were given as a result of this survey. What do you think would appear in the top 9 greatest temptations to Christians? At the top of their list, most of them responded and said materialism was their biggest temptation. We live in a very materialistic society and culture. People are concerned about and just obsessed with getting things and more things and accumulating more things. Second on their list of greatest temptations in that magazine survey was pride. In fact, pride is at the heart of all sin. Third was self-centeredness. Fourth on their list of temptations was laziness. There was a tie for fifth, anger and sexual lust. The seventh greatest area of temptation indicated by the readers was envy, followed by 8, gluttony, and 9, lying. Now, not only did they respond to that question, but the respondents in that survey said temptations were greater when they had neglected their time with God. Almost all of them said that's when they felt the greatest temptation. Some also said when they were physically tired, about half of them said that's when they feel their greatest temptation. But then they talked about or responded to show how they resist temptation. It should be no surprise that things like prayer and Bible study and avoiding compromising situations were near the top of their list of ways to resist temptation. In the bush country of Australia, there is a little plant that grows, and it is called the sundew, S-U-N-D-E-W. Now, this beautiful little plant has a slender stem and tiny round leaves. And around the edge of each of those leaves, there is a fringe of hairs. And those little hairs glisten with bright drops of liquid. You can't miss them if you're close to the plant. And these drops of liquid fringing every one of the leaves are very delicate. But woe to the insect that lands on that plant. Although it is beautiful and has attractive red, white, and purple blossoms, and they are harmless, the leaves of that delicate little plant are deadly. The shiny moisture on each one of those blossoms is sticky, and it will entrap any insect that touches it. And then when that insect struggles to try to free itself, that vibration actually causes the leaves of that beautiful little plant to close tightly around it. And so, that innocent-looking, fragile plant then starts feeding on its victim. And when you think about it, that's pretty much the way temptation works in our lives. We're tempted by things that look so appealing and so desirable. Do this, even though most people think it's wrong. You'll feel better. Take this drug. It'll give you some fulfillment and release from the frustrations and hassles of life. And on, this relationship, why don't you try it even if it's wrong? You need to do what you want to do. Things that look so appealing and so desirable, and yet they lead to suffering and destruction. Listen, we need to beware of pride and a false sense of our own strength to resist temptation. The fact is, you're not strong enough to resist. Not in your own power alone. The Bible says pride goes before a fall. And you know what? Satan knows that. He knows that teaching from Old Testament scripture. Did you know that Satan knows the Bible? And even quotes scripture? Now we're looking at the third of a series of 3 temptations here that Satan presented to Jesus while he's out there in the desert. But the second one of those temptations is when Satan told Jesus to jump off the top of the temple, and that would impress the people below and they would want to follow him. That's a quick route to getting people to follow you and believe in you. Put on a big show for them. Show them you're a master trickster. And Jesus quoted, and Satan had quoted already from the book of Psalms, correctly so, that God's angels will take charge of you and they will hold you up in their hand so you won't hurt your foot on a stone, the cobblestone below. And so Satan was quoting scripture to Jesus and the act of tempting him. And Jesus responded in kind. Listen, Satan is patient. He waits for the right opportunity, and he will attack and assault us where we're the weakest, and sometimes where we think we're the strongest. But nobody is exempt from temptation. But we learn something else from the temptation story of Jesus too. And this one is a very troubling thought. And that is, Satan is the ruler of this world. He is the, quote, ruler of this world, end quote. Look again at verse 9 if you still have your Bible open. Satan showed Jesus the kingdoms of the world from atop this mountain. And in verse 9, the devil said to Jesus, "All these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me." Now, this is a perplexing idea. What does it mean for Satan to say he has the authority to give things of the world to Jesus? Well, three times in the Gospel of John, Jesus calls Satan the ruler of this world. Those are his words recorded in the Bible. But again, what does that mean? Isn't God in control of everything? Well, some background is needed here. And it goes way back before time began. Back in the distant past of eternity, if you will. Did you know that before the world was created, there was a war in heaven? Were you aware of that? Revelation chapter 12 tells us about that. The Bible says that there in heaven, Satan, Lucifer, one of the angels in heaven, created by God along with the others, Satan there in heaven decided he was going to overthrow God and take his place on the throne. He had the audacity to believe he could do it. And so he recruited some other angels in heaven to join with him in this revolt and this coup. Obviously, it was unsuccessful. And as a result, Satan and the other angels in rebellion with him were banished by God to this world. That's why Satan is here. He was banished, he was exiled from heaven to this planet. And as a result, God has allowed him to have influence here for a period of time. Now, this doesn't mean that Satan has ultimate authority, obviously. But he does rule over the unbelieving world in a certain way. He is blinding people to the truth of God. And thinking of that, in 1 John, the writer says, "We know that we are of God and that the whole world lies in the power of the evil one." And so Satan's influence is felt everywhere. In billions of lives on the planet today, in societies, in communities, in nations, and on and on. His influence and power are widespread across the world. And so I believe here's what's happening on top of the mountain of temptation. Satan is saying to Jesus, "I will withdraw my power and my influence over people all over the earth if you will here and now bow down and worship me." Obviously, Jesus would have none of that. He did not come to win the kingdoms of the earth. Instead, he came to give his life to establish his spiritual kingdom forever. A certain man tells about his experience watching a wildcat in a zoo. He said while he was there watching the wildcat in its cage, an attendant, a zoo worker, entered the cage through a door. The wildcat's in the cage. And this man had nothing in his hand but a broom. He carefully closed the door behind him, and then he just started sweeping the floor of the cage. The visitor noticed that the worker had no weapon to protect him from that wild animal. In fact, when the man got to the corner of the cage where the wildcat was lying, he actually poked the cat with the broom. The wildcat hissed at him, and then walked over and lay down in another corner of the cage. The visitor who was standing there watching this in disbelief said, "Well, you certainly are a brave man." The zoo worker said, "No, I ain't brave." And he continued sweeping. The man said, "Well, then that cat must be tame." The worker said, "No, he ain't tame." "Well, if you aren't brave and the wildcat isn't tame, then I don't understand why he doesn't attack you." The worker chuckled a little bit, and then he said with confidence, "Mister, he's old, and he ain't got no teeth." Well, listen, our enemy does. Satan has vicious, deadly teeth. He is in the business of devouring people, and devouring can be considered chewing people up and destroying them forever. That's who our enemy is. And then someone has said, here is what Satan promises. He promises the best, but pays with the worst. He promises honor and pays with disgrace. He promises pleasure and pays with pain. He promises profit and pays with loss. He promises life and pays with death. And so he does. That is our enemy. But then we learn something else from the temptation of Jesus, and that is this: Satan will continue to attack and tempt us. Continue. Now again, we're looking at the third of these three temptations. And the fact is, Satan increased what he offered Jesus each time. The first temptation had to do with physical food. Jesus has been out there alone with the Heavenly Father for a long time, many days. And Satan comes and approaches him with the first temptation. He said, "If you are the Son of God, you can command these stones to become bread." You have that power if you are God's Son. And after all, some of these little stones actually look like little homemade loaves of bread anyway. The need for physical food, that didn't work. And so then it's when Satan took Jesus to downtown Jerusalem, took him up to the highest point on the roof of the temple in the middle of the day. People milling around below. And Satan said, "You know, there's a quick way you can get people to follow you." And I mentioned this earlier. Satan said, "If you will jump off the highest point of this temple, God's angels will take care of you, and the people below will be so amazed they can't resist following you." The ability to impress people, that was the second temptation. Neither of those worked, and so Satan increased what he offered each time, and now he says, "I will give to you all the kingdoms of the earth." That should speak to us, because if Satan can't tempt us in one area of life, if he can't trap us one way, then he will use another approach, and another, and another. You see, Satan is the father of lies. That's how he leads us away from the truth of God and what is good. Jesus said so. He is the father of lies. In other words, every time you tell a lie, or every time someone lies to you, that statement had its beginning in the heart of Satan. That's where it originates. He's not only the father of lies, he's the destroyer and the devourer again. The Bible describes Satan as being like a roaring lion, roaming all over the earth, seeking someone, whoever he can, to devour. He doesn't give up. And so, from the temptation of our Lord, we learn that nobody's exempt from temptation. Satan is, in one sense, the ruler of this world, and he will continue to tempt us. The other lesson from the temptation of Jesus is this: the best way to resist Satan is with the Word of God. Again, look at the example of Jesus. Satan hurled these three attacks of temptation at him. Each time, Jesus responded by quoting Scripture. And it's interesting that each one of those quotations that Jesus gave came from the book of Deuteronomy in the Old Testament. And so when Satan said, if you'll just bow down right here now, be simple and easy, won't cost you a thing. You don't have to go to the cross. You don't have to suffer and die such a horrible way. I will give you all this. I'll just back out of the picture and you can have the whole world and all this in it. Jesus said, get away, Satan, for it's written, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve Him only. So what does it mean to resist Satan with the Word of God? The Apostle Paul, later in the New Testament, dealt with this subject. In the book of Ephesians, in chapter 6 of that book, Paul talks about the whole armor of God. He says in that chapter, finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His might. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the full armor of God so that you will be able to resist in the evil day and having done everything to stand firm. And then he starts a list of spiritual armor that God provides believers. He says, stand firm, therefore, having girded your loins with truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. In addition to all, taking up the shield of faith, with which you will be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation, and here it is, Paul says, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Quite an impressive list of pieces of armor, spiritual armor that God makes available to us. Paul said, put it on. It's up to you to use it. God offers it and provides it. But notice, that list of spiritual armor concludes with the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. That is the only offensive piece of armor. The only offensive weapon that we can use against Satan. The others are defensive. There's something powerful about the Word of God. Jesus understood that as he quoted Scripture to resist Satan there on the mountain. In the Gospel of John, we read, so Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed in Him, if you continue in My Word, then you are truly disciples of Mine, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And so, Christ's Word, His truth, makes us free from slavery to sin and Satan. I believe all of this means you need to get into the Bible and get the Bible into you. What place does the Bible have in your daily life, honestly? Remember, you're not strong enough to resist and overcome Satan. He's too powerful for anybody in this room, anybody watching. The best person, the strongest Christian you know, is still not strong enough personally to resist Satan and his attacks. No, he is the second greatest power in existence. And thank God he is second. God's power is supreme and ultimate. That is what it's all about. The power of God's Word. You may have read the book Mutiny on the Bounty or seen some of the movies by that title. Well, the book and the movies are based on actual events. In 1790, some of the crew members on the British sailing ship, the Bounty, mutinied against the ship's brutal captain. And they took control of the ship. They expelled the captain and officers and others who were sympathetic to the captain. And so as a result, 9 mutineers from the Bounty, along with 6 men from Tahiti, that's where the mutiny or revolt occurred, 6 men from Tahiti and 12 Tahitian women, along with those 9 crewmen, were searching for a spot where they could hide from the eyes of the British authorities, who certainly would be looking for them, and where they could start a new life as they chose. And so they sailed across some of the vast expanse of the Pacific Ocean. And finally they arrived at a tiny speck of land, a little island called Pitcairn. They said, surely nobody will ever find us here.
We'll be safe. We can live as we choose. And so that group of people went ashore on Pitcairn Island and started a new life. Not long afterward, though, one of those sailors who was a mutineer began making alcohol. He found a way to make it there on the island. That's when the troubles began. All kinds of dissension and arguments and fights, all kinds of violence, disease, and murder resulted pretty quickly. And many lives were lost as a result. 10 years after that, still there on Pitcairn Island, there was a small group of native women and children. And only one man left, one of the mutineers, a man named Alexander Smith. Eventually, he found an old Bible that was tucked away in a big chest that had been taken from the ship. Nobody ever thought about it. He didn't remember it was there, didn't even realize it was there. But Smith found that Bible. He started reading it. And he started taking to heart the message in the scriptures that he was reading. And he began to teach the women and children from the Bible as well. That changed everything. A few years later, an American ship landed at Pitcairn, and they discovered there an amazing thing. They didn't know the whole history of the people on the island, those who had died from violence and disease. But when the American ship landed, the members of that crew found a group of people that had no crime, no jail, no serious disease, and they were all living in harmony with one another. Listen, the Bible is the living word of God. It is life. It is power. It has power for daily living. Again, we can't resist Satan because the Bible, the word of God, has power in it to resist Satan and all of his attacks and every form of temptation. Don't go it alone. It won't work. But God has made provision for each of his children to resist everything that Satan tries to do to us. Don't let him have the victory in your life. You depend on God and his word. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for what we learned from the temptation of our Savior so long ago. We thank you for your holy word, which is power and life. And we thank you for Jesus who came to be that living word to fulfill all of Scripture. Help us every day to put our faith in you and what you tell us in the Bible. Help us to take you at your word, to stand firm on it, even when most people around us are not standing for what is right. And Father, give us that special strength and protection when Satan attacks, and he does each day. Thank you for all that you are and all that you do. Lead us now in these closing moments of decision, we pray. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Again, thank you for joining us. And we hope that this time was helpful to you. And we hope that you'll join us again. Maybe you're sharing worship with us through our local cable TV outlet here in our area. Or maybe you've joined us over the internet. If so, we hope that you'll find a time again to share worship with us. And if you live in our area and are looking for a church home, then we invite you to come and worship with us. Our morning worship begins on Sundays at 11 o'clock. And I know that our folks would make you feel right at home. This is a place where the Bible is preached and everyone is welcome. And so, until you can join us again, may God bless you richly.